clarification. Is there a difference between chips per second and bits per second?
Absolutely. There's a tremendous difference here. Chips do not contain information, as a matter of fact, whereas bit actually are units of information, right? That's a very good question. This is a technology predicated on something called spread spectrum, right? We use the chips to spread the bit. If we have data, in time, let's take a bit, a real bit of information, and let's call this time. This is the amplitude of plus one. Let's call this here the bit time, TB. Good. This is for electrical engineers now. Class, for 2,000 points, what's the frequency response of the pulse like this? If you put this in the scope, what do you see in the spectrum analyzer?
It should be a straight line.
Straight line, it will be true if you have a direct delta function. If you have just an arrow, then the response will be flat,
yeah.
Right? Exactly. This is a nice little pulse. It'll be a function called the sync function. Do you remember that? That if this is TB, that's time, then the frequency response is a sine x over x. Right? It's a sync function. If you want to find somebody who's running around a circle, what are the four options that you have?
Wait.
You can sit there or stand there, wait till they come around. Okay? What's option two? You can chase after them in the same direction, but at a faster speed. Three, you can go in the same direction at a slower speed, and they'll catch up with you. Four, you can go the opposite direction at any speed you like. And sooner or later, you'll meet up someplace, right? No cutting across. Of these four options, which is the best option?
Sit and wait.
Sit and wait will be from the energy point of view. probably the best one. But what if the person you were chasing after just went past you, and then you wait again until they come around? Option two.
Opposite
direction. Very good. What if the person you were chasing after just went past you, and you take up the opposite direction?
Another 42 days.
So you can see the point I'm trying to show you here, that it depends on the initial conditions. Right? And the way to do that, I'll count the number of agreements and count the number of disagreements. And by definition, you can say agreements minus disagreements expresses a degree of similarity, right? Good. So let's count this. Is this an agreement? Yes. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 0 disagreements, so it's plus 7. Good. T1 versus CI of T. Is this an agreement?
No.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes.
Yes.
No. 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 3 agreements, 4 disagreements. 3 minus 4?
-1.
Second?
No.
No?
No.
No?
No.
No?
Yes.
Yes?
No.
No?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes. 3 minus 4? -1. T3?
Yes.
Yes? No?
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 Yes?
No?
Yes.
3 minus 4? Well, in case you haven't seen the pattern, it's -1. -1. -1. And then back to +7. This is a very powerful result. And most people don't see this because they don't take the time to do what we just did. It's recaptured as a formula, so you don't see the result. Good. Question then. How many base stations or sectors can we therefore identify with the short PN code that we created in our lesson 2? This is our lesson 2. right? This is the commercial length of practical short PN curves. Using this property here, how many base stations or sectors can we actually identify with that curve? 32,768. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
But there's one little problem. Here's a problem. If we have two adjacent sectors, the green and the red, and the red is leading the green by one chip, and we transmit them together, and the red hits a tall building, and it's late by one chip exactly, what does it look like?
The same.
Like the green, right? So we want to separate those in such a way that there's no probability or a very low probability of having confusion with the multipath, right? With a reflected signal. Now, to see how probable that is, we can first say that the code speed is equal to 1.2288. Look, we have 1.2288, 10 to the 6 chips in 1 second. So the delta time for one chip is 1 over 1.2288, 10 to the 6 seconds. The distance, one chip distance, is delta t times the speed of light, which is 3/10 to the 8 meters per second, divided by 1.2288, 10 to the 6. This is 300 divided by 1.2288. This is approximately 244 meters. So every time there is a signal travel distance of 244 meters, it creates a one-chip delay in the PN sequence world. So really, in practice, if you plan the system well, this would never be a problem, right? So basically what I'm telling you here is that from the 32768, we've reduced our effective subset of PN offset to 512. Right? And that's the subset we'll use to plan our sectors in real networks. Not the whole 32768, but a subset of 512. Okay? So that's a number that you'll see in the literature all the time. And when you see a base station and a sector, let me ask you a question. When you've read the material or any document, how do we identify a base station or a sector in CDMA? By the PN short code number, right? Can you give me an example? PN, give me a number. Have you ever seen PN 120? Maybe. PN, have you ever seen PN 847? Because there's only 512. And what we say 512 is 512 times 64 chips. That'd be the same, it's the same but delayed. So, this is the base station right there. This is you, the mobile, with all kinds of different ships. And you jump in the circle. You jump in the circle. Start here. There. You run, chase, no correlation, no match, no match. There is a little bit. You're starting to catch up. There's a place for correlation. You can stay here if you want. Stay with them, or if you miss them, you just run faster, 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 until you catch up again. And when you stay there, you stay there. So we.